Hello and welcome everyone to this rather delayed version of the Thursday Travel Coffee Break. Normally it's on at noon, and today I changed the routine because it's my son's end of term, and he finishes halfway through the day, and so in order to be there for him at the end of term, I thought I'd shift this to 1700 to 5 o'clock our time. So here we are. It's a slightly odd, as I say, time of the day, and it's also a slightly odd hangout in the sense that I haven't actually specified a topic for today. It's an open forum, and you are most welcome to join us. I've put the joining link on Facebook and on Twitter and on Google+. And if you look for the hashtag TCBHOA, then you should be able to find it, and you should be able to join in. I do have a guest today, Lola Akinmade Akerstrom. Strom?
Yes. Strom? Close enough.
Looking quickly. Lola, I haven't seen... Oh, last time I saw you was in probably in Innsbruck or somewhere.
Yeah,
I think
Manchester.
Was it Manchester?
Yeah, long time.
At one of the Travel Blogger Unite conferences. Yes. Lola is a travel blogger. And a whole bunch of other things as well. Well, Lola, you've got quite an impressive CV. Not least, you're also something of a representative for Sweden because you do a lot of work for Visit Sweden, don't you?
Yes, I do. I do some work for actually the Swedish Institute, which runs the official website of Sweden, sweden.se, and I'm going to start doing some work with Visit Stockholm as well. So that's why I do a lot of stuff. You know, I don't put all my eggs in one basket. So, you know, I'm a freelancer, so that's, you know, I have to kind of divvy up where I get my, I put my work and get my income. So.
That is the way of it, isn't it, these days? In days gone by, professional travel journalists would be writing in effect for either one publication. They'd be in-house for, you know, or at least a very regular writer for a magazine or for a newspaper or whatever it might be. Yeah. And if you were freelance, you maybe work for a sort of a bunch of them. And what you would do is you would go out and you'd do a trip maybe to Hungary or somewhere and write from that several pieces for several different outlets. But these days, freelance travel writers and bloggers and photographers have to be very much more flexible and to find work where they can find it.
Exactly. I mean, and obviously without, you know, losing the quality of your work, but at the same time, you have to put on different hats. You know, you can't just be a writer if you want to, but it's easier for me to approach an editor if I also have photographs, high-quality photographs, to go with the writing as well. So that already gives you just a step ahead. So that's something freelancers have to think about, is what else can they add to their existing skill sets that can make them more marketable, that can give them a bit of an advantage as well.
And it's not just the core skill sets as well. It's not just that as a travel blogger, you are a writer on the one hand and a photographer on the other and a videographer on the third and so on. But you can there are also the sort of the fringe things, and where a lot of what I would call pro travel bloggers make a sizable amount of their income is from teaching, and I know you do that, from speaking at conferences and the like, those sorts of extracurricular activities.
Correct. And that's, I mean, one of my goals for next year is to try and work smarter, not harder. Meaning I'm trying to find ways where I can come up with good ideas that also provide a service but are income generating and also kind of passive income as well. Mm-hmm. So for example, with being a photographer, one way is to find a really good stock agency where I can put, you know, because I've got thousands of photographs that are just sitting there. Mm-hmm. I could go through them and just stick them somewhere that can generate passive income on the side, you know, and things like that. So just looking for ideas where you can take things that already exist or build something that makes you, in essence, work smarter and not just keep working and look and working from assignment to assignment to assignment. So that's kind of one of my goals for next year. And like you said, most bloggers, you know, there's something else they add. It's not just making money just from the blogs. It could be from conferences, speaking, selling ebooks. So you just have to be more creative. It's not just having a singular way of operating anymore. You just have to be more creative in, you know.
Yes. I mean, an excellent example of that would be, I mean, bloggers that we know, like Nelly Hung, for example.
Yes,
who's created that fantastic magazine off the back of her Wild Junket blog, and that's a, I mean, it is an amazingly good magazine. I think a lot of it is down to Alberto, her husband, who's a fantastic graphic designer, because it just looks the business. It looks great on tablet. It looks great on in print, and it's the match of any professional magazine anywhere. In fact, I can think of several that it completely outstrips. So something like that, or another example would be there's a group of bloggers again that we know well, Sarah Lee and Terry, Jody Ettenberg, trying to think who else, Janice Moore, who've got together and are now producing a series of guides, not to destinations, but to styles of travel. So solo travel in the case of Janice, travel as a foodie in the case of Jody, and now they've got an actual publishing brand for all of these that they're selling. So yeah, it's a very powerful way a very clever way of diversifying and finding lots of different revenue streams from as many sources as
absolutely. And the one thing I also want to go back to is again keeping the quality as well, because you want to, and that's why I really like, you know, what Nelly's doing as well as what Sarah and the guys of Travelers and Books are doing, is also trying to find a way of providing something of value that's still very high quality, that's something you want your name to be attached to, and can still bring in income. So it's not just resorting to just selling text links all the time or trying just doing anything. It's actually sitting down, brainstorming, thinking it through, and coming up with really good, solid ideas. So that's, you know, that's what I really like, and I think more bloggers should be doing that.
I think another classic example would be Kash Bhattacharya, who's done brilliantly with. He's a blogger whose site is Budget Traveler.
Budget Traveler,
And what he did was decide to, in effect, create a new site, and I think with it a print publication, or at least a digital publication, which is a directory of the luxury end in the hostel market. So he's been going around Europe to, I think it was 50 was his first batch. He may be on to more by now. Going around Europe and doing reviews and posts and photographs on all of these really rather glamorous, because he detected early on that there's that new generation of hostels where the 30-year-olds now who grew up backpacking and going to hostels now want to go back out and sort of recreate that independence of travel, but they don't want to slum it anymore. They don't want to do it in dormitory. They want, they want double rooms and en suite and all that kind of thing. And there's a new generation of hostels that have sprung up to meet exactly that that market. And he's creating, in effect, a directory for it. And again, it's a very clever way of identifying a niche and doing something with it. I see that we've got, I think it's Tichawanda Darangwa, looks like, trying to join us, not clear. There's no, I can't see a microphone, I can't see a camera, so I don't know whether that's going to work or not. But anyway, if he or she can, then that would be lovely. And the other similar kind of line is somebody like Gary Arndt, who is what we would call a mega blogger, in the sense that he, Gary is a mainstream blogger who has big numbers of followers and subscribers, and so it can survive very nicely just on the strength of his blog alone. But he looks for alternative sources of income, and one of the ones that struck me as being very clever was the getting together with G Adventures and creating his own branded tour. So there's a Gary Arndt photographic tour, which he went on and took, I think, a small group tour, so 15, 20 people around Arizona, learning how to be better photographers out in the national parks and the like. And I think that's a very innovative way as well for bloggers to make extra revenue.
Absolutely, and just again, finding the right brands to align yourself with. You know, it's picking a few brands to work with. Like, you don't have to work with every single brand, because then it's like you just jump in bed, for lack of a better word, jump in bed with every brand. But if you find some really good brands to align yourself with in terms of the message your blog is, you know, is sharing and just the quality of your work, I think that's great. So I think what he's doing is great with G Adventures. And just bloggers picking brands that are really good fits. I think that
it plays to bloggers' strengths, and that really is the name of the game now. Because what you have to do to distinguish yourself is become a center of authority in a niche.
Exactly.
And so if you can really concentrate on the stuff that you know best, if you can be like Jules or Sophie Collard, you know, a rail blogger, and that's what you're known for, and you specialize in that, and you deal with rail companies as brands, and build your expertise up that way. I think that's the way to go if you can possibly do it. So
I agree. And I gave a presentation at Travel Bloggers Elevator that was held in Italy, and one of the presentations was called Finding Your Travel Blog's Voice. And there are lots of travel bloggers that kind of want to get into the game, you know, and you know, there are thousands already out there. It's very difficult. And one of the things I said is just, first of all, find what you love outside of travel and pull that passion into your travel blog.
Yeah.
And that's what's going to give you that unique voice that's going to kind of start building your niche. And so some of the examples I gave was, look, if you like knitting or you like crocheting, it may sound like some, you know, simple little hobby, but if you travel around and actually crochet little flags of every country you visit, or you start doing things that way, start being creative with something you also like, one, you're not going to burn out because it's something you like anyway. It's just a natural passion. Two, you're going to start building that niche for yourself. Or if you like playing, say, the violin, you know, you could play like a bit of the national anthem of every country you visit. You know, you can put that as an audio. That's how you start building niches for yourself. And, you know, like with the train travel and Jules now, that's his niche. Now I know him as, oh, train. If I have a question, I go to him directly. So that's how you start building.
And we send people to them directly as well, because when you know that people are experts in particular kind of areas, you go, oh, you must talk to Jules, or you must talk to whoever it is. Yeah,
exactly. And people also shouldn't be scared that they have been pigeonholed as well. So even if it's your niche and it's something you like, but you want to expand, you will expand later, but just you have to come with a voice. You can't just come being generic. It's just not going to work in this market. And if you look at all the bloggers that are really successful now, most of them kind of got in early in the game when it was, I'll say, like around 2006, 2007. That's kind of when, you know, people kind of started filling in those budget niches, and, you know. And so if you come in now and say, oh, I'm a budget traveler, it's not going to work.
Yes, so. You're right. You need to find and of course that little thing that you have an enthusiasm for enables you to be able to want to write about it. I mean, you have to get up every day wanting to write about it. So, you know, picking something that you actually genuinely do like, even if it is something as crocheting, then is absolutely the way to go.
Exactly.
And again, it's also extremely marketable, because the point is that now the internet gives us the opportunity to exploit the long tail. So where before, you know, you needed to be have a loud voice, now you can have a quiet voice, but in a very specific area. And people, because search is so well developed, will be able to find you. So when Janice Waugh always her quote, and we all use it as the classic example of a niche website, is fly fishing in Alaska. Let's say you're the blogger who blogs on fly fishing in Alaska. Now there's only going to be 5,000 people around the entire world who are interested in fly fishing precisely in Alaska. But every single one of those is absolutely on the target list of a an outfitter in Alaska. So yes, I mean it's definitely the way to go. If you can exploit an enthusiasm you've got. You reminded me when you were talking about playing the violin and playing the national anthem for every country you visit. There's that guy, and I can't think what his name is, who does the dancing.
Dancing Matt.
Yes.
Dancing Matt. That was the example I gave during my presentation as well. And I'm sure people are like, damn it, I'm even a better dancer than he is. But he came up with the idea first, and it's his passion.
And he's practically he's viral now. He has huge numbers. Exactly. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
So it's just, finding that passion. And there was something that Mike Selden said that I really liked. It was about human SEO, meaning, you don't want to just write for SEO and just throw in keywords. But once you start writing about things that you are passionate about, that's already naturally generating the SEO, because you're going to be mentioning those words that are related to your passion.
Yeah.
And it's just going to naturally build it for you. You don't have to, say, oh my God, I have to worry about SEO. It's just going to naturally build
itself. Yeah.
If you're following your passion and actually building that unique voice.
And Google in particular, in the last few years, through the last few dances, through the pandas and the penguins and all of those, has actually become very sophisticated in the way it understands language, and it can smell out and detect false SEOing. I mean, keyword stuffing, all of those sorts of things. Very easily now, it recognizes natural language as opposed to keyword optimized language, and you can only benefit from that. So yes, as you say, I mean, if it's something you write about and you care about, it'll come out, or rather, as Michael Sowden says, it'll come out absolutely. Coming back to you and your full gamut of things, we were talking about your speaking at the one in Italy. That was Alessandro, wasn't it? I can't remember his name now.
It was Michele.
What were you speaking about there? Because in the past, I know you've given talks on writing technique and all sorts of things. I mean, you have a very wide range of subjects that you speak on.
Well, the two things I presented on, the first one was finding your travel blog's voice. Mm-hmm. And this was for people just kind of stepping in to this industry I'm worried about. And then the second one was actually building lasting relationships with your local tourism board. Because a lot of bloggers are quick to jump on blog trips out of where they live. But when you ask them, does the local tourism board know who you are? And if you actually live in their backyard, some of them say, no, I've never met them. And that's a problem. They need to know that you're in their backyard. And so that was pretty much the point of that, is not only should you develop relationships with other tourism boards, but the ones in your backyard, they need to know who you are, what you provide, who your audience is. They could also be a fantastic source of income. They also provide in-depth knowledge and content for you.
Yep.
And so I'll send you a link to the presentation, but it really goes into lots of, the advantages of why you need to build that local relationship, as well as ways on how to approach them. And again, I use that with my relationships with Sweden and the different tourism boards I've worked with around the country. And and one of the things also is, because in addition to being a blogger, because I am a writer photographer, since I'm based locally, sometimes they don't have to fly me in. They fly journalists and other people in just to cover something where I can hop on the train and get to quickly.
Yeah.
So that's also another advantage, if they know you're writing for the same outlets as the journalists they are flying in. So that's the point, is just making sure, you build a relationship as well locally, instead of just always trying to go somewhere else.
But dare I say that for you, in a sense, it's slightly easier, because, or your job is made easy in that respect, because the Swedish Tourist Board in particular, and I'm imagining it sort of trickles down through the regionals to the locals as well, are really quite ahead of the game and digitally advanced. Witness, for example, the very famous
Twitter account,
the Sweden account. I mean, we should just say for anybody who doesn't know, so this was about a year ago, I think, that Sweden decided very bravely that they would open up their Twitter account to to people in, you know, ordinary people, ordinary folk. Correct. You could just apply to go on, and be for a week. You would be the voice of Sweden. And some people have been very controversial. Some people have had very controversial lifestyles and things like that. Mm-hmm. But it is a very brave move. So you're lucky. You've got Sweden, and they are sort of ahead of the game. So for somebody else, let's say it wouldn't be fair to pick a country, but I can think of a few who aren't as digitally advanced. It might not be quite so easy for them to engage with the local tourist office.
Well, and that's the thing, though. That's why they actually need to know that you are there, because if, for example, if Sweden wasn't that cutting edge, but I live locally in the background, I can actually start building a relationship with the tourism board and showing them, see, this is what others are doing. I can help you. I am local. You know, so even if it's a tourism board that's still struggling, that's still behind, that's where you, as the blogger, you've got your finger on the pulse of what's going on, can actually help well. Yeah. And so that's what the presentation, it's got lots of just examples like that. Even if they're not that way, that's again an opportunity for you to go in, make some income, and also build that relationship as well.
We should welcome Tichawanda.
Yes.
is that how I pronounce it?
Yes. I've been trying to change it to just Teach, but Google Plus, I don't know how to do it there. So.
Well, welcome, Teach. So should we call you Teach?
Yeah, Teach. Thank you for having me. I was just listening to your conversation earlier about blogging and monetization in the travel industry. It's a very interesting topic. It's a very interesting topic, which I'm very interested in, by the way.
Tich, are you blogging yourself now?
What I do, I do not have the patience to blog, but I've been working with a lot of bloggers, especially in the travel industry, those who are collecting people's names and emails, and I just request to do solo ads through their lists. That's how I've been monetizing the whole thing.
Oh, okay, you're putting ads onto bloggers' sites or onto lists, or
basically what I do, right? Most bloggers, they've got these places where you subscribe to their to their things, right? So they are building a list, right?
Oh, I see.
So
what
I do, I'll go, let's say to you, you've got a list of subscribers, right? And I'll say, I'll give you, let's say, $1,000 to send an email with my offer to your subscribers.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's basically, because I found that a lot of bloggers, they've got all these lists, but they don't know how to monetize them. With people like me, we've got the products which are targeted, and we don't have the time and the patience to what? To blog. So that's how I do it.
So Tich, what are the products that you're promoting?
Right now I'm promoting travel discounts. It's a membership club.
And that's an international one, or is a local one, or how does it work? Where are you based, by the way? I'm not sure. I don't know where you're from.
I'm from the United States originally. Okay.
You're in the United States now.
Yes. Hold on. I'm just getting a lot of noise here. Let me just quieten everyone here. Give me 1 second. Go ahead.
It's slightly... actually, I was noticing earlier on, Lola, that the it is slightly staccato. The signal seems a bit to be freezing every now and then, for me at least. I don't know if it's working okay for you, but it's not. It may be. It sometimes it happens, particularly this time of day. The internet's under a bit of a strain, so it may just be that it's one of those things. But it's perfectly workable. But, sorry, Tich, I didn't catch that. So you are in the United States, or
I'm in the United States.
Right. Okay. And so. And so the discount travel you're selling is discounted. It's agency travel. It's ticketing on for overseas.
Actually, no. You know, it's an MLM, right? What we do. Have you ever heard of Global Resorts Network?
Mm, not sure. No.
Or World Ventures.
I've heard of World Ventures. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, I sell World Ventures.
Okay.
So what we do, right, if you put a product like World Ventures in front of a targeted audience, people who love travel, it's like, you know, they just joined left, right, and center because it's basically discounted travel at anywhere you want in the world. Right?
Okay, so it's kind of like a membership.
Yes, it is.
I got you.
Yes, it
is.
So what I do... That's what I just get these bloggers to run for me. So if I spend, let's say, 500 sending an email to their list, right?
Yeah.
I get, let's say, depending on the size, if it's, let's say, it's a subscriber base of 2,000, yeah. I'll make my money back plus extra down the road.
Okay.
Oh, that's right. Okay. So that's a very high response level, isn't it?
You see... You've got people who follow you, right? Mm. People who love whatever you write. So when you send an ad, let's say I send an ad to your list, it's got like you are endorsing me.
Yes.
Responses are extremely high.
Okay.
And that's what we were talking about earlier on about the business of the exploiting the long tail of hitting particular niches, because it may be that any one blogger has perhaps not that many followers, but let's say they've got 2,000 followers, but in their particular area, let's say that they specialize in writing about Eastern European countries or the Baltic countries, for example. Mm-hmm. If you've got product. Tich that is suitable for that. I don't know. Is it components, flights, hotels, that kind of thing?
It's basically every element,
right,
of travel, right?
Okay.
Like right now, most of our sales are coming from countries like Austria, Hungary, Slovenia. Germany is always a leader. The United Kingdom, and all of a sudden. A US-based company finds itself that most of its business coming from Europe, you know, things. And South Africa is also up there. South Africa, Kenya, and Zimbabwe, of all countries.
All right, okay. And so, are you when you're using those lists? I mean, you're working with bloggers who are writing all of them in English language, or some of them in other languages. In other words, are you going to a Romanian blogger and working with them and their followers in Romanian and sending?
Okay, with me, I don't mind if I can find, let's say, a Slovenian blogger, right, with a good following, and they've got the target audience. It makes more sense for me to go with them with a Slovenian presentation. But mainly, I don't mind what language it is, as long as it's the same language with my target audience. Because we've got presentation in this company for each and every country we represent. If it's Germany, we've got a German presentation. If it's Hungary, we've got a Hungarian presentation. If it's Slovenia, it's Slovenian also. That's how it is. Even South Africa, we've got Afrikaans presentation. Zimbabwe, we've got Shona presentations. So if I can find a Zulu blogger, even better, because traffic would be cheaper for me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But it's very targeted.
Yeah.
No, that's exactly right.
So everything's about targeting. So when I heard you that most people, they want to blog, right? And they want to put ads on their blogs, right? What I found that when you put, let's say, a banner on your blog, right, you have to have an extremely large amount of traffic going there, because only 1% are going to take action, less than 1%. So if you are just asking people to say, okay, give me your email, you find that most of the visitors will give you the email. They like you already.
Correct.
So you turn around when you get those emails and come to a person like me and say, Teach, give me 500, you can send an email to my list. You are monetizing your work without even having to sell yourself. That's easy money.
So, go on. Titch, when you do that, let's say you go to a blogger and you say, look, I'm interested in buying your list. Do you do it as a one-off thing?
No. Okay. There are certain elements.
Sorry, excuse me one second. A baby is crying in the background. I'll be right back.
There are certain elements which are important there, right? First thing, I need to find out how fast your list is growing, right? If your list is growing fast enough, I don't mind even sending an email once a week, right? So that means for the blogger, they've got a recurring income already, right? And also, not everyone on your list is going to open each and every email you send, right? So I'll check, okay, how many of my emails were delivered, how many were opened, and how many people purchased, right? Mm-hmm. If I'm getting good results, trust me, I'm going to do it over and over and over and over and over. But depending on what, how often your subscribers open the emails. You know, yes, go ahead.
So for bloggers listening to this, Lola, by the way, I muted your mic, so you'll need to, somewhere up the top right-hand corner, you'll see a microphone. You can unmute yourself there. So, Titch, if I'm a blogger listening to this, and I'm thinking, oh, this sounds interesting, because normally my revenue streams for the blog are, as you say, putting banner adverts up, or maybe a sponsorship, or maybe a sponsored post, links in a post. But this sounds interesting to me. What sort of level of revenue can I get from it? I mean, what typically would a blogger get?
The first question is, how big is your list? That's the first thing which determines everything. Mm-hmm. And how responsive is that list? Let's say you send an email. What percentage of those people actually look at that email? Right? Let's say you've got a list of, let's say, 20,000, and you get like 10 people opening the emails which you send, it's useless. Right? But if you've got a list, let's say, 1,000, and out of that 1,000, you get like 700 people opening that email. Mm-hmm. That is extremely valuable, right? So if you can send 700 eyes to my offer, 700 eyes, not people taking it, just to look at it. We track the clicks, not the actions. People who clicked on the link in the email. That's what we track. So if you can send about 700, you can charge something like $500. Right? So if you can send like 2,000, you can even charge $2,000, depending on the quality of the list. If, let's say...
And that would be 2,000 for a fixed period or for...
No, just for that email.
Right, okay.
So it, let's say...
For one email shot or...
Okay, you sit on your autoresponder. Let's say use Aweber or any of those autoresponders, right? Email clients. And you send an email to your list, right?
Yep.
Let's say 2,000 subscribers. I pay the 2,000 for you to send the email. That's it.
Yep.
You get it?
Okay.
So what will keep me coming back to you are the results.
Yeah.
If I get good results, next week I'll pick up the phone and say, you know what, can I send another email? That's what we do, right?
Okay.
Or I'll come to you and say, you know what, I did not get very good results. Can we renegotiate on the price? And what, then now what? Like, do you know of this site, Akamax?
No, don't think I do.
Okay. Akamax, what they do, they also have a very large list of what people who enjoy traveling, right?
Yep.
They've got different categories. They've got over 200,000 subscribers. They make over $1 million a year just by letting people email to their lists.
Okay.
And they've got over 200,000 subscribers. So Yes.
One of the things that I'm very aware of amongst the particularly the pro bloggers in the blogging community, the travel blogging community, is a determination to have, you know, to maintain that relationship with their readers, and they're very protective about their readers. So what they need to do in this arrangement is be fairly sure that what you would be sending, the products you would be sending, as it were, in their name, are going to be that they are comfortable with.
That's the most important thing.
Yeah.
That's the first. That's extremely important. Like what we do, we send the offer first. That's the first thing which we do. We send the offer first before anything else.
So they can see it.
Yes. Then you approve it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Most of the times, we send free offers. Most of the time. It's a free offer to a capture page. So they opt in onto my list. Then I will promote the travel thing. Right? Yeah. Or you can say, okay, instead of you paying me $1,000, I'll charge you $500. You send directly to the offer, not to a capture page, right?
Yeah.
That way, I've got no way of continuing to market to these people. So you send to a landing page; it's a one-time thing. So they are different.
That is interesting. Are there many of you? I mean, do you have many competitors?
Sorry, guys. Can I jump in real quick? I actually have an assignment. I'm so sorry I have to jump.
That's okay.
The call, but sorry, Tich. It's been wonderful chatting with you and just learning more about what you do, and Alistair as well. And I'll be in touch and hopefully make the next one. Yeah, but absolutely. Sorry, I actually have to run off on an assignment.
No problem. No problem. Okay. Come and
you
go.
Guys, have a great one, guys.
Okay. See you, Lola. Bye. Yeah, where was I? Oh, yeah, so are there many of you? I mean, do you have a lot of competitors?
There are hundreds and thousands of people who do exactly that. Okay. You see, it all started with Google. I don't know if you see it.
Mm-hmm.
With Google, right? Google in 2009, they were hit by a lawsuit, right? What happened was a lot of marketers online were promoting work from home things, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people were not actually making money from these things, right? They were told it's get rich quick thing.
Yeah.
You actually have to work. So they started suing Google. And what Google decided to do, they turned around and any work from home marketing type of thing, they did away with it.
Yeah.
So it took away a place where we could market our things. So we started looking around. Where else? Facebook now, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now,
mm-hmm.
Facebook is good, but it's expensive, and sometimes it's not targeted.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided, why not look for people with targeted lists already, people with relationships already, right?
Yeah.
So if you type online and look for solo ads, that's what a solo ad is.
Okay.
And you get hundreds of thousands of people looking for this kind of traffic. Like, for instance, with me, I'm an online marketing coach. I've got over 2,000 students. Each and every one of my students would love to get what? Targeted traffic.
Mm.
Then I'm also a member of what? This network marketing company called World Ventures.
Mm-hmm.
I've got 24,000 people on my team. Each and every one of those 24,000 will give anything to get access to targeted lists. So, there are people like Dagan Smith, right? If you know Dagan Smith, this guy, all he does, he's got an advertising agency, right?
Mm-hmm.
An online advertising agency. All he does, he brokers these deals.
Okay.
That's all he does. And he makes an average of $300,000 a month just brokering these deals. That's how big this industry is.
So for you, Tich, you're just specializing in travel, or there are other sectors that you work in as well?
With me, there are about 12 different sectors which I work in, because I also have got an agency for these things also. So I've got people who do, who are in travel, people who are in make money from home, people who are in crochet, people who are in diabetics of all things.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah, weight loss, you name it.
Yeah.
We've got it all covered. Okay. If we can find other new sources of traffic which are untapped, that's gold.
Excellent. Okay. Do you have a website?
I've got what I have. I've got capture pages.
Okay. So if when I wrap this up, which I think I'll probably, if there's only a couple of us, I think I'll probably do fairly shortly now. But it'll go to YouTube. What I'd want to be able to do is to put your, so, you know, somewhere that they can, viewers can go and see what it is we're talking about and find out more about it.
Now, it would be difficult for them to see it because the only place I have this, it's actually a product which teaches people how to do this.
Okay.
So don't be fair for me to take your traffic and send them there.
No, okay. Well, not to worry. I mean, they can find you. You're on Google Plus anyway. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, if they Google Teach the Great, they'll find me. And
Teach the Great?
That's what they call me.
Okay, Teach the Great.
So now, in terms, if you've got access to lists of people who love traveling, you can also make a lot of money. Yep. Right, you've got the targeted audience already. You join, let's say, like the company I'm with, right? And you've got people to market the product to. Mm-hmm. And like the nice thing about the product, you don't get paid once, you get paid over and over and over and over. It's something which you can leave for your kids for retirement and all those things.
Well, it's the one thing that the travel bloggers in particular are always interested by, because for many travel bloggers, the travel is a passion, and what they want to be able to do is to find a way to monetize that, and it's a difficult process because, as Lola and I were describing, the what I would call the professional travel bloggers are the ones who actually write all the time as a blogger or as a photographer, but also do lots of other things off the back of it, and that can be producing magazines or books or guidebooks or guiding tours or speaking at conferences, teaching, all of those sorts of things. So it becomes sort of multi-stream. But if you're actually out there traveling and what you want, all you want to do is to raise some extra money to be able to pay for your travels, then any form of advertising is useful and interesting. Any revenue stream is useful and interesting. So it might be worth something that that you know people can follow up on.
Okay, like for instance, I've got a question for you. Do you have access to bloggers who've got lists who would love to monetize it?
I know a lot. I don't. I mean, you can, and you can find just as easily as me on the on Google. For example, with the new communities, we've just started one called Travel Talk, and there are, as of about an hour or so ago when I looked, about 700 members on that.
Yeah, that's where I found this link to here.
Absolutely. And likewise, on Facebook, if you go to Travel Bloggers Network or any of those, there's one called Travel Bloggers and there's one called Travel Bloggers Network, and they've got a good 1,000 to 1,500 members each, and they're all travel bloggers. So you can find them that way. And there are now people who are creating directories of bloggers. I know of one that's about to launch in January. So the answer is no. I mean I personally know a lot, but I don't have a list of them as such. I know them. and write about a lot of them. So I don't think there are many people who have a definitive list as such, but they are beginning to come out.
Oh, okay. Now I've got a question for you. You see how you wrote your name on the screen? How do you do that?
Ah, right. It's a little app called Lower Third, and there's two ways for you to do it. Mm-hmm. If you look at on the side of your screen, you'll see a thing that says Lower Third. You could use that, and that'll do it directly.
Wait, you see where it says Lower Third? I see where it says View More Apps and says Add Apps.
Just above View More Apps, does it say Lower Third? Usually, Lower Third is one of the best known apps, so it's usually in that sort of top thing. But if not, if you click the View More Apps, you should find it there. But the other one to look out for is the Hangout Toolbox. And the reason why the Hangout Toolbox is a better one is because you can't run two apps at the same time. So Hangout Toolbox actually combines Lower Third. It's got Lower Third in it, and it's got several other things, a volume control, and it's got a soundboard, for example. So I can you'll like this one. I can do that. I can do.
What's the name of that one?
It's in the Hangout Toolbox.
Okay.
And if you look, as you know, what you can do is you can create a Hangout at any time, and you don't have to invite anybody. So you just press the Create a Hangout button, give it a title, test, don't invite anybody, and set it going. And then you can play with these things and see how they work. And you're not affecting anybody or anything. So.
So how do you invite people to Hangouts?
Two ways. You can invite them by having them in circles, which you then, in my case, when I start this one, I invite everyone on. I've got a big circle of about 100, 200 people on it, and that automatically goes out to them. But then what you do is you take, if you look at the top of the screen, I don't know if you can see it, but there should be a... the URL will be plus Google and then /Hangouts and then a long, horrible number.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. If you cut and paste that, then anybody you send it to can use it to join in.
Oh, okay.
Up to 10 people. Hangouts will take 10 people, including the host, so 9 people and the host.
Oh, okay. No, this was actually nice just to hang out, you know. It's different when you work from home. You know, I rarely go out. I just sit behind my computer.
Yeah, thank it's an easy way to do it. So.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
Okay, well,
go ahead.
Good of you to join us. And these hangouts, they're a regular thing. If you go to the website, it's travelcoffeebreak.com, all one word. Then you'll see there's a schedule and a list of them. They happen on Mondays and Wednesdays and Thursdays. More and more people are now doing it because more and more people are coming to Google and coming to Google Plus. So I think Hangouts are looking quite
excellent. I'm going to think of doing it and do a monetization one. You know,
brilliant.
How to monetize your efforts online. You know,
brilliant. All right.
Thank you.
Tich, good to see you.
Pleasure's all mine. I hope to see you again.
Hope to see you soon. Okay. And to everybody else out there watching, the next one will be on Monday. It'll be at noon GMT. And the subject for Monday is disabled travel, accessible tourism. So if you've got any expertise on that, do come along. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Bye.